oluşturmaya devam ediyor. Kafkaslar'da her ne kadar bugün Ortadoğu'ya benzer bir Bakut veyahut da her gün kan aktığı, her gün kan akan bir ortam söz konusu olmasa da hatırlayacaksınız geçtiğimiz ay Ermenistan-Azerbaycan ateşkes hattında çeşitli çatışmalar olay geldi. O bakımdan buradaki donmuş sorunların da henüz çözüme kavuşmadığı bir ortamdayız. O bakımdan bir yandan Türkiye bölgeselleşmedir, Türk dış politikasında bölgeselleşmeden bahsettik, bu manada bağlamından atıldığını söylemekle beraber aynı zamanda yakın çevremizdeki bu çatışmaların, bu sorunların tam manasıyla çözülmediği bir atmosferdeyiz. O bakımdan bu konularında Türk dış politikasında birer sorun alanı oluşturmaya devam ettiğini görüyoruz. Ben burada konuşmamı bitirirken Türkiye-Japonya ilişkilerinin diplomatik ilişkileri 90. yıl münasebetiyle buraya gelip bize, bizimle beraber olduğunuz için hepinize teşekkür ediyorum. Umarım bugünkü tartışmalar, bugünkü paneller oldukça birbirine geçecek. Hepiniz için olumlu sonuçlar, öğretici sonuçlar olacak. Tekrar teşekkür ederim.
I would say it has been one of the few universities to support the the Turkish Japanese relations professors and by the head of the International Relations Department has personally supported such studies and myself. I also would like to thank him once again to use that opportunity. Now, let me open the discussion. We are going to start with Professor Yamaguchi. He is going to talk about a very hot topic. It is on the agenda of international affairs, the rise of China, and what it means for the region, but also how Japan sees it. Professor Yamaguchi. And we are going to use around 8-10 minutes for each speaker, so that we have also some time for discussion at the end. Please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ambassador Yokoi, distinguished scholars, ladies and gentlemen, this is my great pleasure to be here. Actually, this is my first time to be in this country. And I'm particularly glad to see this friendly people. And I'm very, very glad to speak to that kind of friendly audience. Because I have been talking to audiences in Korea and Japan, Korea and China, for the last six, 7 months. I have attended 5 conferences in Seoul and Beijing. Atmosphere there is totally different from here. And very glad that it is. Another reason I'm very much glad is the topic in Seoul and Beijing. I have been forced to talk about the history in the past. It is hard to survive. And the good news is I have become very, very good at dodging from under the crossfire from Chinese and Koreans. But today I have to worry about that kind of blitz flying to me. My topic is China's rise, less people than the US Obama bias. And as Professor Kitaoka mentioned earlier, Japan's defense policy after 1945 is very, very restrictive and peaceful. Particularly after 1950s, our defense policy relied on a couple of elements. First one is Japan was so devastated, so economy first was the policy. So that then Japan didn't have the capacity to spend too much money. So we decided to depend on the U.S. military presence in the region. So U.S. defense commitment to the region and defense build-up of our own, even though the amount is smaller. While the Turkish military has been spending over 2% of GDP for military expenditure. We have been spending just below 1%. So relatively small military and a better economy was attained. And after the Cold War ended, we now have a new set of strategic environment. Particularly now, we are facing. My question is on China and the United States. Before getting into the points, I have to warn you, I am a very much optimistic and simple soldier. So I don't see anything beyond two dimensions. So I always use two dimensions figures. This is a simpler one. From left to right, it shows how strong the U.S. commitment will be to the Asia-Pacific region, or to the region close to Japan. And from bottom to the top, means how nice China lies, how nicely China lies. From the top, nice and the accommodative China, and on the bottom, that means very nasty, aggressive, authoritative China. So my hope is above right. U.S. remain committed to the region, and China is nice. That is my dream. And meanwhile, and China is rising in a very nasty and aggressive way. That is a nightmare. And the other two, nicer China without use of men, that means kind of good Sino-centric decision. And the right, bottom right means Japan is going to be in the front line in the confrontation model of the U.S. and China. I'm not telling you what will happen in the future, but rather I'm telling you that on the right side of, above is a place that we need to aim. How to keep the U.S. commitment to the region is one of the issues for us, and how to make shape the China's goals to better and nicer Chinese. This is somehow close to what Professor Katana Kitaoka showed, but it shows a rapid growth of China's military expenditure. It has become 18 times larger in the last 20 years. It's a lot. But other side of the coin though, is 20 years ago, China used to spend this much. As you may know, performance of the military forces are not depending upon how much you spend this year, but how much you have been spending in the last 20 to 30 years. Accumulation is important. In that sense, the good news is Japan's spending in the last 20 years almost a flat. So we have had a kind of with accumulation. This is kind of joke. This shows the military expenditure of the major countries, major allies of U.S. Germany, Spain, France in the 1982 to 1992. There was only country, even after the Cold War, kept increasing its military expenditure. Do you know from? Yes, who? My students usually say North Korea or China, but that is Japan. Because of bureaucratic kind of inertia, we kept spending, kept increasing our defense expenditure up until the end of the public. Because of that, we have a pretty good accumulation. But the accumulation, the stockpile of that money is running away. So it is almost a time to go up. Abe administration has decided to increase some defense budget. That is the news. This may be interesting for you. It's a picture of Senkaku Island. Mutual Security Treaty. Not necessarily 100% of Japanese know, but Mutual Security Treaty have two most important articles, Article 5 and Article 6. Article 5. Article 5 is the most important. This is Article 4 for defense of Japan. We have U.S. and Japan are going to defend Japan. But there are three conditions when the mutual security treaty is Article 5 works. One, it must be under Japanese administration. And in this context, the Senkaku, this island, those islands used to be under the military, U.S. military control administration before 1972, when Okinawa was divided. And it is clear that Japan has administrative control over the Senkaku island. But second condition, it must be armed attack. Fishing boat running into coast guard ship is not an armed attack. And the Hong Kong activists, 10 Hong Kong activists swam onto the, it's not an armed attack. Those are the things the Japanese government are supposed to take care of. And thirdly, if there is an armed attack, not necessarily the Senkaku, but any place in Japan, this must be joint action. So sometimes people ask the question, whether U.S. is ready to defend some islands or not. And my answer is, the question is wrong. It depends. if Japan does not stand up to protect our territory, US has no reason to stand up and to protect us. Joint action is the key. And as to the American commitment to Asia, Obama's administration has been making clear that America is going to commit it. And particularly from 2011, when Secretary Clinton made a very excellent piece to foreign policy. And U.S. is for sure coming back to Asia Pacific region. And this shows my interpretation of people to Asia. If you look at the U.S. Force structure deployed around Iraq and Afghanistan, U.S. has been deploying nearly 200,000 service members for almost 10 years. If you have 200,000 troops there, you have two other sets to rotate them. That count to the 0.6 million people committed to those two areas. That is over. In 2012, it became 77,000, and end of last year, it became 53,000. So burden on the American shoulder is really much, much better, much, much lighter now, so that U.S. can come back to the, not necessarily Asia-Pacific region, but rather normal shoulder, normal posture. So let me end my remarks by talking about the relation between Japan's defense policy and U.S. strategy. American military is very much concerned about operations under anti-access area denial embargo. They are worried about, for instance, having aircraft carrier close to Okinawa, which is west of Second Island Chain, where the land-based air force or submarines, Chinese submarines, and other assets can affect American operations. To overcome that kind of environment, Japan's defense posture in the southwestern islands makes very, very good sense. If we have a better posture in defense in southwestern islands, that means Japan's self-defense forces want to put the umbrella to the forces, U.S. forces deployed in this area. If U.S. forces deployed more to this area, Japan may become easier to defend ourselves. Then the deployment of foreign forces will become much far easier. So, yeah.
Second speaker is Serj Çolakoğlu from Ibrahim University. He has been one of the few experts, Turkish experts on Asia and Turkey's relations with Asia, along with Bahat Hoca. Now we first have Serj, and he's going to talk about Turkish policy towards Northeast Asia.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you also for your kind words. So we try to obviously raise the awareness about aging in Turkey together with our colleagues. So I will try to analyze the Turkish policy toward Asia in general, not only in particular North Asia, because North Asia is not a very known frame in Turkey. As we know, for international literature, when we talk about the conflict between Japan, China, the two Koreas, Taiwan, and maybe Russia, and the United States. So, but when we look at Asia, usually we can maybe add Northeast Asia to Southeast Asia, ASEAN countries, and also South Asia, also looking at Asia. When we look at Turkey's foreign policy, or Turkey's look to Asia in general, since the beginning of the Cold War, we can divide the four categories periods. The first one is the early period of Cold War. So during that period, Turkey has a security dimension for its foreign policy. So solidarity with the Western capitalist kind of the pro-Western regimes in Asia, and also solidarity against the anti-communist countries. So in this regard, Turkey sent troops to Korean War. So Turkey actively participated in Korean War, and also participated in the defense of the South Korea at the time. So also Turkey has a solidarity policy with South Korea, the nationalist China, and Taiwan, Japan, the Philippines, Thailand, and Pakistan. But there's a pure security look to Asia in general, but the exchange of economic exchanges and also cultural exchanges remain very limited. The second period of Cold War started with the Sino-American normalization in the early 70s. So after the Sino-American normalization, also Turkey has normalized its relations with the People's Republic of China and also closed its embassies in Taipei, and then transferred embassies to Beijing. So also Turkey's look to Asia has turned from security perspective to economic perspective. So also Asia had some very successful development models, starting with Japan, and also four Asian tigers, that means South Korea, Taiwan, Singapore, and Hong Kong. And Turkey's main focus on economy at the time. This period covers the 1970s and 1980s. There is an increasing awareness, and also there was an increasing partnership, particularly with Japan at the time. So the third period has started with just end of the Cold War and the dissolution of the Soviet Union, the dissolution of the communist bloc. So and also we witnessed the outbreak of the newly independent countries, most of the Turkic countries in Central Asia and Caucasus. So Turkey has much more focus on this region for its foreign policy priority. At the same time, Turkey tried to develop a bridge from West Asia, where it has located, to East Asia. So there is a how can say Turkey in building up new Silk Road, contemporary Silk Road, and so on. So Turkey could pay more attention about the rising China and also ASEAN countries at the time. But because of the how can say economic crisis at the time, so Dr. Özcan outlined the Turkish foreign policy perspective for 1990s and also 2000. So because of the economic how can I say shortcoming, the Turkey cannot develop fast its relations with the Asian countries at the time. So also there's the economic capacity problem. But when we start when we look at the third term, starting with the early 2000s, so there's an increasing economic capacity also. So the economic capacity is the key to develop the Turkey's relations with Asian countries, because all the time Turkey paid much more attention to Asia. But for political level and also economic level for planning, but the capacity could not build up during that period. But during last decade also Turkey has succeeded to build up its economic capacity, and also there is an increasing partnership with Asia. So also there is an increasing profile for Turkish, increasing Turkey's profile in international, how can say, arena, international organizations. For example, Turkey has become UN Security Council non-permanent member 2009-2010, adapted to active policy within NATO, and also very adapted to active policy within the Organization of the Islamic Conference. Turkey has become an observatory country for the Arab League and also the African Union, and also Turkey signed a cooperation agreement with ASEAN in Hanoi Summit at the time. Prime Minister Davutoğlu participated this signing ceremony, and also Turkey finally has become a dialogue partner for the Shanghai Cooperation Organization in 2012. So all these, how can you say, Turkey's appearance in international arena, and also Turkey's rising profile also for Asian countries and also for Asian institutions. So Turkey developed some strong partnership with Asia. Also, when we look at the trade figures, Turkey developed very strong economic relations with Asian countries. Japan is the key country. Turkey has developed very strong economic trade relations, and also Japan, Japanese FDI also flowed to Turkey starting in 1960s, 1970s, and 1980s. Until the year 2000, Japan was the leading Asian trade partner for Turkey. But starting in 2000, there is a decreasing role for Turkey's trade partnership in Asia. So China, then China has become number one trade partner. Then South Korea also passed Japan, and also finally India passed for Japan. So Japan is now number four trade partner for Turkey in Asia. So maybe we need to focus on that, why Japan decreased its economic role for Turkey's perspective during last decade. So, but on the other hand, also they Turkey developed very strong economic relations with Asian countries. In that regard, China has become number three economic partner for Turkey since 2008. Of course, there are lots of, how can I say, achievements, assessments during last decade. This is true. There are lots of high-level visits from Turkey to Asian countries, but also from Asian countries to Turkey. And also there are lots of signed deals and also agreements and also cooperations on the different level, from the state level to NGO level. This is true, but also continuity and sustainability of the relationship, Turkey's relationship with Asian countries is another important dimension. So also the lack of roadmap is another challenge for Turkey. There are some ups and downs. So sustainable relationship with Asian countries is very key, important. So also during the last decade, also especially in recent years, Turkey had an Asian opening policy. So in recent years, Turkey opened some embassies in some in some countries like Myanmar, Cambodia, Brunei, Nepal, Sri Lanka, etc. And also those countries also trying also have a policy to open an embassy in Ankara. So there are lots of connections, development relations, and also good achievements for Turkey's Asia policy. But also we need to focus on some strategic then, section of those relationship. This is all coming up.
Scholars on Turkey in Japan, and to reflect his knowledge of Turkey and Turkish, he's gonna give his presentation in Turkish, and then Professor Mayton will be talking about the regional dimension of Turkish foreign policy, the stabilizing role Turkey has been playing in the surrounding regions.
Thank you, Chief. Saygılar, dinleyiciler. Günaydın. Sözün başlatmadan önce Mısır'da IŞİD'in rehinleri hakkında bütün rehinlerin sağ kurtulmasını kutluyorum. Biz Japonlar da bu mutluluk ve sevincini müsaadenizle sizinle paylaşmak istiyoruz. Gözünüz aydın. Japonya ve Türkiye arasındaki ortak akademik çalışmalarını derinleştirmek amacıyla düzenlenen bu konferanstan bir konuşmacı olarak katılma fırsatı bulmuş olmam benim için son derece onur verici bir olaydı. Bunu öncelikle ifade etmek istiyorum. Orta Doğu ve Avrasya'daki istikrar sağlama adına Türkiye Cumhuriyeti'nin rolünü kısaca şöyle değerlendirmek mümkün. Batı ile Müslüman dünya arasındaki köprü olmaz. Filistin ile İsrail arasındaki diyaloguna köprü olması, özellikle çaresiz durumuna kalan Gazze hakkına karşı yardımcı olması. Kafkasya'daki kırılgan durumuna karşı caydırıcı gücü sahip olması. Orta Asya'dan Türkiye'ye kadar uzanan enerji koridorunun güvenliğinin sağlanması. İran'ın nükleer silahlanmasına karşı caydırıcı gücü olması. Garanti devlet olarak Kuzey Kıbrıs Türk Cumhuriyeti'ndeki Türklerin hayat ve mal güvenliği sağlayacak. Afganistan'ın istikrar ve kalkınması için kilit rol oynaması vesaire. Ama son gelişmede kaosa düşen Suriye'de kaçan 1 milyona yakın mülteci için en büyük ve en ciddi destek veren ülke Türkiye. Geçen hafta sonu Suriyeli Kürtlerin Şanlıurfa'ya giriş yaptığını yeniden öğrendim. Ve Irak. Ya Irak savaşının hemen sonradan parçalanma tehlikesine karşı karşıya gelen bu ülke, mezhepçi siyasetinin sonucu olarak IŞİD'in çıkması artık son derece belirsiz ve istikrarsız kırılgan ülke olmuştur. Türkiye, komşu ülke olarak Irak'ın bütünlüğünü korumak için caydırıcı gücü olmaya çalışmakta ama ciddi sorunlarla karşı karşıya geliyor maalesef. Son yıllarda böylece Türkiye, Orta Doğu'da tek demokratik hukuk devlet olmuştur. Hatta Türkiye, dünyaya karşı insani adaleti ciddi anlamında gösteren tek ülke olmuştur. Bu tutum nereden kaynaklanıyor? Bana sorarsanız, birincisi olarak vatandaşların çoğunluğu Müslüman olması ve ikincisi olarak ülkenin üniter yapısı. Sonuç olarak Türkiye, başta hiçbir Müslüman ülkede bulunmayan demokrasiye geliştirmiştir. İslam dünyasında Batı'ya takip edenler ile, yani Batı'nın kopyacı ile mücadele ederek Müslümanlara uygun bir demokrasiyi gerçekleştirdiği tek ülke Türkiye. Ne yazık ki Arap Baharı'nın sürecinde 30 yıldan fazla diktatörün altında kalan Mısır halkı ilk kendine cumhurbaşkanı seçti. Ama darbeci Mısır ordusu ona ortadan kaldı ve destek verdiği Müslüman kardeşlerine idam cezası vermişti. Bu Orta Doğu ülkelerde demokratikleşmeye karşı ne kadar büyük engel gücünün mevcut olduğunu gösterdi. Ve Mısır'daki darbeden dolayı Türkiye bölgede en büyük orası ittifak ülkeye kaybetti. Bu üzücü bir olay. Belirsiz bu bölgede istikrarın sağlanması tabii ki son derece zor bir iş. Bunun için Türkiye'nin oynadığı ve bundan sonra da oynayacağı rol gayet açıktır. Orta Doğu'daki tek demokratik, laik, sosyal ve hukuki bir Müslüman devlet olan Türkiye, sağlam üniter yapısıyla birlikte kaos durumunda düşmüş olan Irak, Suriye, Mısır, Filistin, Libya, Somalia, Yemen ve Afganistan'daki bütün insanların tek umududur ve aydınlatıcıdır. Onun için gerek Gazze'de yaralanan çocuklara, gerekse darbecinin saldırı altında mahsus kalan Mısır halklarına yardım etmeye devam ediyor. İşte böyle doğru dürüst davranış, geleceğe doğru Türk ve bütün Müslümanların, Müslüman gençlere haklılık nedir konusunda yol göstermek. Sayın Cumhurbaşkanımızın 2009 Davos'ta gösterdiği açık ve net tavrı da bunun bir kanadıdır. Ama maalesef Türkiye'nin böyle adaletli tutumuna destek veren ülke gittikçe azalıyor. Türkiye'de de geçmiş 12 yılda Türkiye dost ülkeleri kaybetti diyenler de var. Ama ben bir Japon bilim adamı olarak sözde değil, özde dostluk ilişkilerini kurmak için en önemli şart adalet ve ahlak olduğunu vurgulamak istiyorum. Eğer inancınıza uygun bir adaleti dağıtan tek ülke olaraksa da Türkiye'nin tutum, yeni Türkiye'nin birinci sayfa olacağı kanaatindeyim ve ona saygılıyım. O kadar karmaşık kaos durumunda Türkiye'nin dış ilişkilerini hakkında tek tek değerlendirmek mümkün değil. Dolayısıyla en son gelişmeden biraz da bahsetmek istiyorum. Konu İslam devleti. Yani IŞİD'in vahşi olayları Türkiye'de bütün dünyaya tehdit ediyor. Burada benim böyle bir hassas konuya girmesi yanlış olabilir. Ama ABD Başkanı Obama'nın ittifak çağrısına kolayca olumlu bir cevap vermediği ülke o da işte Türkiye oldu. Tabii ki başta Mısır Başkonsolosu olmak üzere 49 Türk vatandaşının rehin alınması bu hassasiyetin sebeplerden birisi. IŞİD'e karşı mücadele konusunda ben Batı ülkelerinin vizyon noksanlığından dolayı ondan biraz istisna ediyorum. Devlet başkanı olarak IŞİD'e karşı kanser vermişti. Tabii haklı. Kanser varsa cerrahi doktor onu kesip çıkartabilir. Her ne kadar kanser büyük olursa olursa. Ama bu teoriktir. Sonuçta insan ne olacak? Ameliyatına dayanamayan insanın ölümüne yol açar. Askeri operasyonun olumsuz sonuca son derece hassas olan Türkiye'ye saygı göstermeliyiz. İngiliz Başbakanı Cameron ise IŞİD'in gazetecinin kafasına keserek öldürdüğünden dolayı şeytani bir eylem demişti. O da haklıydı. Ama o zaman geçen Ağustos ayında Gazze'de 500'e yakın çocukların öldürüldüğü zaman niye şeytani bir eylem demedi? İşte bu çifte standart hep Müslüman gençlerin cihatçı olma ihtimalini büyütmedi. Ancak burada hatırlatmak istediğim bir nokta daha var. Körfez Savaş döneminde Türkiye, Amerika Birleşik Devletleri'nin ittifakına katılmadı. 11 Eylül'den sonraki Afganistan'a karşı askeri operasyona da katılmadı. Tabii Türkiye sadece ISAF'e katılıp güvenlik işlerine büyük katkıda bulundu. 2003 yılın Irak Savaşı'nda da Türk Büyük Millet Meclisi'nde uzun tartışmadan sonra nihai kararı olarak ABD'nin çağrısını kabul etti. Türkiye, bölgede Amerika Birleşik Devletleri'nin en önemli müttefik ülkesi. Ona rağmen her zaman bölgedeki hassasiyeti iyice dikkatli alarak karar vermişti. Özellikle bu hükümetin İslami adaletine uygun bir şekilde karar alınması bence çok mantıklı ve rasyonel olduğunu inanıyorum. Türkiye gelecekte bölgedeki güvenlik sorunsuna kilit bir ülke olarak nasıl bir rol oynamaya devam edecek? Bunun için sadece siyasi profilin yüksekliği veya sadece asker gücünün büyüklüğü yeterli olmayacak. Bunun yegane yolu ise hiç şüphesiz ki Türkiye, Türk milletinin kendi dayanışma ve çabasıyla gerçekleştirdiği sivil toplumuyla ülkenin temel niteliklerini çağdaş dünyaya uygun görülen bir şekilde birleştirmesidir. Tamam. Son olarak, Türkiye ile Japonya arasında hiçbir sorun yok. Türkiye ve Japonya, Batı ile Doğu dünya arasındaki köprü işlerine sağlaması birlikte yürütmektedir. Batı ile Doğu uygar arasında jeografik yer olarak farklı ama biz beraber köprü olmaya çalıştık ve bundan sonra da çalışacağız. Onun için Türkiye ile Japonya arasındaki ilişkilerimiz daha da güçlendirilmesi gerekmektedir. İki ülke arasındaki köprünün temeli sağlam olmazsa hafif bir rüzgar onu yıkabilir. Ama temel sağlam olursa fırtına ne kadar güçlü olursa da bir davul olursa bile köprü dayanıklı. Bu konuda Japonya Türkiye dostluk ilişkilerine başlamıştan beri hep iki halk arasındaki insani yardımların üstüne inşa edilmesi çok önemli husus olarak görüyorum. Japon halkına rahmetli eski Cumhurbaşkanı Turgut Özal'ın 1985'teki İran-Irak Savaşı'nın sırasında İran'da mahsus kalan Japonlarının kurtarılması için Tahran'a özel bir uçakla gitme kararı almasını asla unutmamalıyız. Pek çok Türk vatandaşlar İran'da kalmış. Türk hava yollarının uçağı Irak ordusunun sarılma riskine erdirmeden Japon halimine yardımcı olmuştur. Ona karşı Türkiye'den hiçbir eleştiri ses çıkmamıştır. O da işte Türk halkın Erdoğan'ın fırkateli faciasına ne Japon halkın Türk denizcileri kurtarmaya çalıştığını unutmadığını gösteriyor. Böylesine kararlı bir tutum Türkiye'nin bölgedeki faaliyetlerini insanlığa faydalı olduğunu göstermektedir. Bu da işte Müslümanların temel inanç olan yardımlaşmadan kaynaklanmaktadır. İnançlı, dindar insanların dürüstlük ve disiplinli faaliyetle bölgede vazgeçilmez bir sahip olan yeni Türkiye özgür bir tutumdur. Çok teşekkür ederim.
Generally, the
talk about activism starts with the other administration, but to be fair, actually the Japanese foreign policy has been active before the Abe administration. The difference is Japan has been active in multilateral terms. As a global citizen, Japan promoted regional integration, was a very influential actor in international organizations. What changes with the Abe administration is that actually maybe Japan also puts emphasis on bilateral relations. What is important here is that when you look at the Japanese foreign policy, it has a very clear goal. Japan is a promoter of regional integration. Japan has been very important in creating the success of East Asia. I would like to make a comparison between East Asia as a region and Middle East as a region. Now, today when we talk about East Asia, we talk about success, high growth rates, huge hundreds and hundreds of millions of population rising up from the level of poverty or rising up from the middle income. A number of countries actually rising to the high income level in the world is from Asia. It's the center of production in the world. Korea, Japan, Taiwan, Singapore are innovators of technology. We use their products everywhere. They are leaders in technology. All these nice success stories are there. Come to Middle East. We talk about ISIS, massacre, wars, coups, despotic regimes, religious conflicts, ethnic conflict. All the nasty things come to our ears. There's a drastic difference between the two regions. Now, this hasn't been the case all the time. Asia hasn't been the success story all this time. As a matter of fact, in the Cold War, Asia was much more violent place than Middle East is today. In Cambodia, for instance, one-fourth of the population was decimated, massacred, in a civil war. It was a self-genocide. Compared with Syria, it's not as bad as Cambodia, yet, let me say, today. But very similarly, like there was a Pol Pot regime, a fundamentalist communist regime, now there's a fundamentalist religious regime in Syria, and the same horrors might repeat in Middle East. It's not only Cambodia. Vietnam was in war for decades. Laos was the same condition. Indonesia had insurgency against Malaysia and Philippines. There were always civil conflicts in this area with coup d'etats in Thailand, in Malaysia, in Indonesia. So the whole region, you could say, was a war zone with coup d'etats, civil strife, massacres, genocide, everything. It changed so much. Look how we are talking about Asia today. Japan had a very important role in creating this change. Japanese government actually was very active, maybe behind the scenes in multilateral forums, in creating a region. It started from Batsumaba, actually. Japanese companies were important in creating production networks and production chains. Japanese government gave ODA, development assistance, to Asian countries. It promoted and funded Asian integration, regional integration efforts. Japanese government also applied trade policies that would integrate the region. So, no matter how realistic you look at international relations, here is a fact that internal trade, investment, integration of economies brought harmony to Asia. And it brought peace. It didn't solve problems completely. There are still conflict points in Asia. But it's so different when it was in compared to what it was in Cold War. So I always had this dream, maybe Turkey could play a role like this in Middle East, because it is important. Now the regionalism is the future of the world. We know European Union is in Europe. NAFTA is in North America. There is Mercosur and other initiatives in South America. There are other initiatives even in Africa. In the ex-Soviet geography, there is CIS and SCO. In Asia, there is ASEAN and ASEAN Plus 3 initiatives of regional integration, economic integration. And in Middle East, there is nothing. There is D8, which didn't work. Maybe mostly probably because they couldn't separate political issues and economic issues. The Arab League and OIC are talking shops. There's a gaping hole in the Middle East. There's no region in the Middle East. There's no effort to push countries to integration. Turkey tried to play this role a few years ago, but there was the onset of Arab Spring, so it didn't go anywhere. So, what I'm trying to say here is that Turkey can learn a lot from Japanese experience. And Turkey limited in its capacity, of course, can try to emulate Japanese success in East Asia to create a Middle Eastern integrated region where economies are dependent on each other, where people are visiting each other. There isn't even a student exchange network in the Middle East. So, my question here is that can Turkey promote regional integration and learn something from Japan, and can Japan be a partner in helping to create a region here in the Middle East? True, there are serious differences between Japan and Turkey in creating a region. Even up until the 1990s, Japanese economy was as big as the rest of East Asian economy. Turkey doesn't have such a dominant economic position in the Middle East. But still, even though there are handicaps, maybe in support from Japan and other countries, Turkey should, I believe, try to create a region in the Middle East, try to create interdependence, try to create economic networks, production networks, and also create human networks so that maybe Middle East one day will turn something like East Asia will rise up, the region might rise up from the hellish situation that it is right now, and maybe create something like the Asian success in the end. Professor Kitaoka, in his keynote speech, also told that Turkey and Japan can promote global governance. This is also important, I think. Now, countries like Turkey and Japan have more advantage in this new world where the international organizations are more influential in the world, and countries like Turkey and Japan can be more effective through multilateral channels by cooperating with each other in international organizations and promoting peace and development in the rest of the world. As a matter of fact, both countries share the same global political values. Their cultural values might be different, their family values might be different, but both countries share the same democratic ideals. And I believe there's a huge potential between Turkey and Japan to make a change in the world and also in the region. And I hope we'll find a way to bring this into fruit. Thank you very much.
Registered Shia refugee to Turkey is now 843,000. In addition, it is estimated that more than 500,000 non-registered refugees came to Turkey. Please look at a sheet. Turkish government provides 22 camps located in 10 provinces for protecting Syrian refugees. Turkish government has also established 25 internally displaced persons, IDPs, camps around the borders for protecting Syrian refugees. This operation is named as a zero-point operation. In addition to protecting Syrian refugees, recent Turkey has given aid to Iraq's displaced troops and Yazidis who escaped from Islamic State attacks. Japanese government has also carried out humanitarian aid towards Syrian refugees. Specifically, Japanese government has provided 800 tents, 10,000 jerry cans, 10,000 blankets, and 10,000 sleeping mats to Syrian refugees. Besides, Japanese government has contributed to grant aid up to $155 million for Syrian refugees. With respect to humanitarian diplomacy towards Syria, Turkey and Japan provided grant aid for Somalia, and both countries also cooperated to educate Afghanistan police. So like this, both countries actively commit to implement humanitarian diplomacy. So in this presentation, briefly I overview the concept of humanitarian diplomacy and characteristics of Turkey and Japanese humanitarian diplomacy. I briefly summarized the concept of humanitarian diplomacy in 4 points. Firstly, the humanitarian diplomacy has been shed light since the end of the Cold War. Secondly, the main object of humanitarian diplomacy is not so much the sovereign state, but individuals. Thirdly, the main aim of humanitarian diplomacy is human security, which are protecting peace from threats and difficult situations, and empowering people for independence. Fourthly, humanitarian diplomacy is a characteristic of developed, nor democratic countries. In other words, humanitarian diplomacy is one of the standards to being developed, nor democratic countries. Next, I overview the ideas of Turkey's humanitarian diplomacy. According to Sayın Prime Minister Ahmet Davutoğlu, humanitarian diplomacy is one of the key explanatory principles of Turkish foreign policy, probably the most significant one in this period. In Turkish case, the importance of humanitarian diplomacy has been mentioned since 2011. For example, Turkey claimed open door policy towards Syrian refugees from spring 2011. Turkey was the host country of the 4th United Nations Conference on the Least Developed Countries, so-called LDC countries, held in May 2011. And Turkey also provided financial aid for Somalia in August 2011. And the theme of the 5th Annual Ambassador Conference, which is besides the foreign policy aim for each year in Turkey, held in January 2013, was theme was humanitarian diplomacy. The aim of the Turkish humanitarian diplomacy has three aspects. Firstly, to provide better service to Turkish citizens. Secondly, to pay attention to crisis areas. And thirdly, to participate in the humanitarian activities within the United Nations system. These are Turkey's humanitarian diplomacy. In addition, the main actors of Turkey's humanitarian diplomacy are mainly Turkish Cooperation and Development Agency, Tika, and the Disasters and Emergency Management Presidency, APAT, and Turkish Red Crescent. Yeah, of course, several NGOs. Now, Prime Ministry as a platform for justice and development parties, humanitarian diplomacy. So now, for my understanding, coordinators of humanitarian diplomacy is Bashra Gandhi, Prime Minister. Next, I take a brief look at Japanese humanitarian diplomacy. Japan is one of the leading country which has adopted the humanitarian diplomacy since the end of the Cold War. Broadly speaking, Japanese humanitarian diplomacy has three characteristics. First one is two contributions, as Professor Kitaoka mentioned, to United Nations peacekeeping, to include not only the civilian personnel, but also its self-defense force. Second aspect is to support the concept of human security and to contribute to establish the Commission on Human Security in the United Nations in early 2000s. Third aspect is to implement ODA project through Japan International Cooperation Agency, JICA. Lastly, I make a brief comparison between Turkey and Japanese humanitarian diplomacy. According to Human Development Report 1994, freedom from want and freedom from fear are two pillars of humanitarian security, humanitarian diplomacy and human security. And humanitarian diplomacy initiated by Japanese government is based on freedom from want. In other words, Japanese government put importance on aid policies about economy and social areas. In contrast, for example, Canada and Norway have adopted freedom from fear as a main topic of human security. So I consider the case of Turkey. Currently, stance of Turkey's humanitarian diplomacy is covering both freedom from want, for example, TICAS activity, aid policy, and freedom from fear, for example, Turkish Red Crescent and APAT's activity in Syria. So, conclusion, Japan has know-how about human security, humanitarian diplomacy, especially aid policies. Turkey has know-how about the situation of neighboring regions, including Syria and Iraq. Both countries are candidates for non-permanent members of the United Nations Security Council for the term 2015 to 2016. So humanitarian diplomacy is one of the attractive areas for Turkey and Japan to cooperate with each other. And JICA and TICA have set joint meetings in many years. But in addition to this cooperation, in particular, I suggest that both governments work together for taking care of Syrian refugees, especially who are in outside the camps in Turkey. Because now Turkey's capacity for receiving refugees is reaching a limit, for my understanding. A lot of troubles happen in many cities, not only border cities, but also big cities like Ankara and Istanbul. So for Japan, it is a suitable choice to assist Turkey's open door policy for its aid policy. For my understanding, humanitarian diplomacy is one of the attractive areas for both countries. Thank you for your attention.
Now I would like to open the panel for discussion, contributions, feedback, and also questions from the audience. We are going to have the mics around, and if anybody is willing to
make a contribution, raise a question, please just raise your hand, and also please introduce your name at the institution.